Welcome everyone to Conquests of Camelot. I'm your host, Lostwolfe, and like I said, we're going to look at the manual. This isn't going to be a very long or very involved look at the manual, because the manual has a lot of information. But I want to get a sense across of how important the manual is to the game. Here's the opening page. This is the Librex Doctrina. And then we've got the Conquests of Camelot, obviously. This is the actual, instead of the manual, King Arthur, the Search for the Grail. The stuff that's important is the stuff sort of below this line here. What's very interesting about this game is that it has a bibliography. Now, back when I was playing it in 1990 or 1991, I had some of this information, but I didn't have all of it. So what I would do is I would, because you're going to see this is very much based on real world research that Christy Marks went out and did. And in fact, the bibliography does what you're supposed to do with a bibliography. It lists the pages and the dates and the names of the books that you pulled information out of, which is super cool. That's a very interesting way to write a game. But the stuff that's important is all the stuff over here. So, as an introduction, this is your castle. One thing that you'll see throughout this, and I'm going to show you very quickly, is it will give you all the in-game maps. So this is Southern England, for example, and we've seen this map in-game. Now what it allows you to do, which is pretty interesting, is it allows you to fill in the names that we were reading out yesterday into little slots over here, so that you would sort of know where you were going to go in-game. Anyway, so we got Conquest of Camelot, there's History versus Myth. Over here, she talks a bit about some of what I was saying. The myth of King Arthur sort of started in sort of 800 AD, and then it kind of got expanded and expanded and expanded until more or less, like I said, 1300 or 1400 AD. And as it went, it grew. It started off as a simple little story about a guy who happened to be a powerful warrior king, and then stuff just got glommed onto it. That, for example, the Grail story wasn't part of the original story at all. It was just added on much, much, much later. So this talks a lot about the myth of King Arthur. Now, it's totally probable that King Arthur was an actual person, finding historical evidence of a Camelot is basically impossible. So, my best uneducated guess, because I'm not real educated in this sort of thing, is that more than likely, and she mentions this here, word got around this warrior king who was super strong and, you know, very powerful and had great knights, and that was used to drive sort of, because the Romans had been invading England at this point, and at various factions, in fact, the French and so on, kept trying to invade England, and this was used as a tactic to kind of scare those people off. Anyway, so here we see that bit of the map, and she goes on ever more about this whole idea that the myth of King Arthur was built up over time. She talks over here about the Grail and the Sacred Cup. Now, over here, she mentions that the Grail got added in late, like as late as 1400 or 1500, and then kind of stuck to the rest of the story. But since the Grail is so important to the game itself, she went ahead and talked a bit about how the Grail works and what it does and what it means to the Arthurian legend. This is a bit of a spoiler, the Europe and the Middle East, but it stands to reason. We've seen the introduction already, we've seen Arthur praying, and we know at this point that we're going to end up in the Middle East. It's probably a foregone conclusion. Here is the kind of note about how the Grail story got added in, and what, again, it means and that sort of thing. Here's another important thing. Remember that Guinevere was talking about the message of the rose, and she said to remember the message of the rose. Now, the message of the rose in this case is love is my shield, and that's going to be important. And then The other thing that's sort of related to this is the language of flowers. We've seen this before in other games. One of the games that we came across this in was Dream Daddy, where, if you'll recall, one of the dads that we dated in that game told us that flowers, during especially the Victorian era, had meanings. But this is a super old thing that goes back way, 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 all the way to antiquity. Flowers have always had meanings. They've just sort of, you know, changed as time has gone along. But here, we have, I'm going to read the first three just so you can see what it means. We've got Almond Blossom, which is hope. We've got Anemone, which is withered hope. And that's the opposite of this, of course. We've got Asto, which is afterthought, and so on and so forth. And it goes all the way down like this. Now, this is going to be super useful because there's going to come a point where we're going to deal with flowers. And here we've got the Miraculous Bush of Flowers, which is showing us a bunch of different flowers. And don't worry, that will happen in the game. The other thing that's important in here is there are six goddesses. Now, this has to do with the as I said, we're going to go to the Middle East, Europe and the Middle East, and this has to do with that. So there are six goddesses, and they talk here about Astarte and Athene, and Sirius and Isis and Venus and so on and so forth. And these are all sort of important because of the Roman part of the Arthurian legend. Because, like I said, at one point England was very, very sort of under the thumb of Rome. It had been taken over by Rome, and the English people drove Romans out. But of course, as a result, they would have gotten indoctrinated into Roman religion and Roman culture. So they would have known about Isis and Venus and so on and so forth. We have Vesta here, and the mythology of Aphrodite, Aphrodite and Adonis. It's a super important story when you think about that kind of thing. Aphrodite and Pygmalion, and Aphrodite and Hippolytus. And then, as I said, she's got a whole bibliography here. So it's very cool. This is very awesome stuff that she's drawing from to make the game. And this is why, in this era, you didn't normally throw away the manual, because the manual was so important to playing the game. But that's about it. That's all I have for you today. The next video that goes up will actually be gameplay again. I'm sorry about this, but this is important and you need to see it, because it ties in so much into the game. It's like the manual from King's Quest 3. If you didn't have that, you're going to have a hard time. It's like some of the old Gold Box games, the SSI games. They had journal entries. This is a bit like that. So, it's important, and I thought that you should see it. Anyhow, thank you so much for watching. I've been your host, Lostwolfe. This has been a very quick look at the Conquests of Camelot manual. I hope that you enjoyed this look outside of the game at things that influence the game. As I say, tomorrow we'll go back to gameplay. I hope everyone has a wonderful evening, and good night for now.